Hello, dear viewers. Today, in GriftBits, a new series that will be all about listening to grifters in their own words, we will examine the case of Paul Joseph Watson, who has become a femicide apologist, at the very least, promoter, one could say, just to own the Libs. So let's check out what's going on. So Paul Joseph Watson was the other day on Twitter, and he had a few things to say about Mr. Putin, the ruler of Russia. So here we see Paul Joseph Watson, grifter extraordinaire, link an article of himself, basically using himself as a source. Anyway, linking an article of himself on Twitter. The article is from summit.news. You know this is serious because it says news. And anyway, that's Paul's website. That's prison Paul's website. Very funny. Anyway, so what Paul had to say is that President Vladimir Putin remarked at a recent Kremlin meeting that some countries are replacing the word mother out of concerns for political correctness, something he hoped would never happen in Russia. And let's listen to that exclusive segment right now.
Вот вы сказали, что слово мама невозможно заменить. Оказывается, возможно в некоторых странах.
Yeah, слово мама. So basically all the calories Putin spent on this topic, on this very serious topic of the word mother, is a remark he made in a meeting.
Заменили. Родитель номер один, родитель номер два. Надеюсь, у нас этого никогда не будет.
Yeah, okay, we get it. Amazing. Now, Paul, he's covering Putin's lip service to the word mother. But what are mothers usually affected by, among other things? Domestic violence, one might think. Anyway, let's see where this grifter narrative is going here, with Ilya Aristov commenting on Paul Joseph's tweet that liberal ideas are slowly but progressing in Russia. Well, they're progressing slowly in Russia, I guess. I'm afraid that eventually Russia may become involved in such global policy when government would not view family in any traditional way. So we have a full looming grifter scenario here. We have a narrative going. There's a global policy, supposedly, and Russia shouldn't be involved in it. And this Ilya Aristov guy is probably Russian himself, and he's afraid that liberal ideas might progress in Russia, you see. And then what would Russia do? It would stop being this bastion of freedom and human rights? Wait a second. Isn't Russia the place where gay people practically have no rights, trans people practically have no rights, and everyone else is struggling too? Journalists getting suicided and vanishing? Weird thing, this Russian bastion of freedom that would be, you know, polluted by liberal ideas. Very interesting narrative here. Very interesting narrative. Let's see where Paul is going with this in his Summit News article. Putin: in some countries, the word mother is being replaced. I hope we never, never do that in Russia. We never have that in Russia. Okay. You see, Putin is worried by the deletion of the word mother. Okay, when your mother calls you on the phone, what do you call her? Mother. Ha! Gotcha. Anyway, so the genius thinker and journalist of our times, Paul Joseph Watson, is filing this story under the esteemed section Clown World. Clown World, yeah. This is from Clown. Of course it is from Clown World, because as we will see in this video, Paul Joseph Watson is being an absolute clown, and he's presenting, Putin, a femicide enforcer, as somebody who cares about the word mother. Okay? So, let's read a bit. President Vladimir Putin remarked at a recent Kremlin meeting that some countries are replacing the word mother out of concerns for political correctness, something he hoped would never happen in Russia. Okay, what else happens in Russia that's worse than this? Everything. But Putin is worried about this. Okay, and a good grab for Paul Joseph. He's gonna use the wise words of Putin to own the liberals in the West. Right, right. Now, I don't know if we have to read through this article. It's fairly boring. Because it's basically 50 seconds of Putin saying something, and now Paul Joseph Watson has to read all sorts of connotations in it to expand the content, I guess. When Putin made his statement, anyhow, the officials attending the Council for Interethnic Relations laughed. But for many in the West who are told to accept such absurdities in silence, oh my God, silence, lest they be punished for a myriad of potential thought crimes, it's not that funny. Okay, supposedly, Paul Joseph Watson is saying that allegedly in the West, if you use the word mother or something, you face repercussions for thought crimes? Never heard of that. Some terms in some government forms and services are neutralized so that people that do not necessarily use the word mother to describe themselves and anyone else, like people who adopt kids, can be registered in the forms as a parent and stuff like that. Have you ever heard of anyone being jailed for using the word mother? I haven't. Give me a link. It would be a new one. Let's see how Paul is finishing this. That good-natured response masked the looming uneasiness that yet another crazy train has departed the Western station and is on a collision course with Russia, as well as the rest of the world, writes Robert Bridge. Another fool, I presume. Will Russia be able to hold out forever against the globalists? Ultra-liberal agenda now threatening the planet. Okay, so we went from the word mother being changed in a few government forms and documents to the ultra-liberal agenda now threatening the planet because a word changed in a few forms? As we previously highlighted, a discussion on one of Russia's most popular TV shows about a boy in Scotland who was suspended for saying there are only two genders underscored how people in Eastern Europe are completely bewildered by the West's obsession with identity politics. So, a tyrant, a murderer of journalists, a tyrant of his people, Vladimir Putin, has issues, and the people who support him here in the West have issues that a boy said there's only two genders and was suspended. First of all, there's not much, there are not many sources here referring to that event, but let's see what the reality is really about. Is the West collapsing under the weight of the word mother and political correctness? And is Russia a bastion of freedom that protects everything that the liberal agenda is about to destroy? But just to finish off the kid example, maybe the boy in Scotland meant to upset or harass people in the classroom, and that would be a breach that got him suspended. But okay, let's hold that from an entire article of quoting a tyrant who is criticizing the West, supposedly, and quoting other little grifter reactionary leeches like Robert Bridge or whoever that is, of how them describing how Putin is basically resisting the globalists. And all the examples they could get was a boy in Scotland who was suspended. Okay, but supposedly the general theme here is motherhood, caring for motherhood, something which is in danger by the liberal elites in the West. Okay, then. Well, here's friendly Russia. Mother Russia, friendly to the mothers. Domestic violence in Russia. 40% of all capital offenses committed in Russia take place in families. 26,000 children are abused by their parents every year. 10,000 children and teenagers run away from home. 36,000 Russian women are beaten by their husbands every day. 12,000 women die as a result of domestic violence every year. That is one woman every 40 minutes. 60 to 70% of the victims do not seek help. 97% of domestic violent cases never end up in court. You see, this is how much Russia respects women and motherhood. And the source, by the way, is the Russian Interior Ministry. Next slide. Russia just signed a bill to decriminalize domestic violence. This must be from back from 2017. In Russia, 38 women die every day from domestic violence. That's more than 10 times the women killed in the US, which is twice as many women live. So, around 3 women die every day from domestic violence in the US, which has double the woman population of Russia. In Russia, it's 38 women per day. Can you sense the femicide here? Can you sense the femicide? Yeah. Because this is femicide, and this is how it looks like. Abuse of any form takes place in 1 to 4 families. Great. 2/3 of all homicides are linked to domestic and family issues. Amazing. Russia is really the bastion of freedom. The number of domestic assaults on women and children has grown by 20% in 2015 compared to 2010. That's Putin's Russia. Right. 40% of all violent crimes are committed in families. Astounding, right? Okay, here we are. Domestic violence in Russia. Well, these are similar to some of the numbers we saw earlier. So let us get a grip of what's happening here. Paul Joseph Watson woke up in the morning and he had to do what he does every day. He had to attempt to own the Libs. And he got the words of a tyrant, Putin, who, apart from being restrictive against journalists, leading many of them in arrests or even worse, apart from being an enemy of human rights and gay rights, he also is leading the Russia that has this domestic violence problem, which reaches the scale of a femicide. And despite all these factors, all Paul Joseph Watson had to say about the topic is that Putin said kind words about the word mother. This is the level where grifters will stoop to. Paul Joseph Watson is quoting a known tyrant. He's painting him in rosy colors. While a femicide takes place in that country, to own the Libs. Do you people realize the scale of this bullshit? This is too low, okay? You can find silly liberals in the West and make fun of them if you want to, if you're so inclined. But quoting a tyrant and painting him in rosy colors just because he said kind words about the word mother. Okay, he didn't do any legislation, he didn't do any campaign, there wasn't any legwork involved. It was a silly statement on an otherwise differently oriented discussion he had with some officials. So Watson had to fish that one line Putin said to present him as a nice, respectable person that defends the values supposedly the liberals attack, and present him in a positive light, and that he respects the war mother. And the other idiots that Paul Joseph Watson was quoting are presenting Putin as somebody that fights the globalists. This is the toxic fume the people who are convinced by the grifters are inhaling, people. This is dangerous. And if any of the viewers listening here are taking grifters seriously, this is the fumes you're inhaling. A supposed fighter for the West and freedom like Paul Joseph Watson quoting a tyrant to own the libs. But let's check where the rabbit hole goes, basically. Okay, so just as a starter, European court slams Russia over domestic violence case. Ruling means justice for victim, first step towards direct policy changes. So all the way back from 2017, the problem of domestic violence in Russia was getting so out of hand that the European court had to say something about it. Great. You see, at least in Paul Joseph Watson's head, womanhood and motherhood are connected. So if Paul Joseph Watson was so interested in the fate of the word motherhood, why the hell would he tolerate the femicide, literal femicide, that is taking place in Russia? Anyway, let's see what the European court found. In its ruling, the court said that Russian authorities are reluctant to acknowledge the gravity of the problem of domestic violence and its discriminatory effect on women. The court ruling means that at least one victim of domestic violence in Russia has seen some justice in her case. Well, we see Europe doing too little too late, because the domestic violence stats in Russia that are horrible go back ages, to be honest. Let's read just a bit more, though, just to get a good, gloomy taste of what it feels like to be a defenseless woman in Russia these days. HRW's report detailed obstacles survivors of domestic violence face in reporting abuse and obtaining help, including social stigma and distrust of police. It described common patterns of abuse, including how violence escalates systematically over time. Women described being choked, punched, burnt, threatened with weapons, sexually assaulted and raped, and subjected to psychological abuse, among other offenses. This is Russia, the bastion of freedom, where women are afraid daily that all of the above things will happen to them with no recourse to justice. Great. At the same time, Human Rights Watch found that police treat survivors of domestic violence with hostility and often fail to open criminal cases or conduct investigations in cases of domestic violence. Instead, they force victims to seek justice through private prosecution, a process that is both expensive and demanding upon the victim. Russia lacks a national law against domestic violence and does not recognize domestic violence as a standalone offense, which makes it difficult for Russian government agencies to keep comprehensive statistics. Russia has even decriminalized the first instance of battery among family members, meaning that the first time domestic violence is reported to police, it is treated as a minor transgression with mild penalties, signaling to abusers that the violation is a less serious offense. Russian law also has no protection orders, which help keep women safe by prohibiting contact between a victim and her abuser, and Russia doesn't have enough shelters for domestic violence survivors. So, Putin paying some lip service to the word mother in an obscure discussion with his officials was important enough for Paul Joseph Watson, the filthy grifter, to cover in an entire article and then tweet about it. Great. But the femicide taking place, the mass murder of women, yes, that's what it means, that takes place in Russia, it's not important enough for Paul Grifter Watson to cover. Very convenient. And just to top the Grifter Madness app, Gab Trans, Gab basically on Twitter, is celebrating Putin, the tyrant who oversees a femicide. Why? Because Russia bans Pornhub and YouPorn and tells citizens to meet someone in real life. So, okay, whatever your opinion is on pornographic images or footage on the internet, seriously, you are going to cheer for a tyrant that leads to the death of 12 to 14,000 women per year because the actions of his own government? It's almost as if Gab is not really about freedom. Anyway, a lot of the right-wingers had a chance to realize that in the recent porn wars on Twitter, where Gab is suggesting that porn should be banned or age-gated all over the internet, with, you know, verification of identity for use and stuff like that. And the free speech bros are going against them. But anyway, this is beside the point. I will examine it in another stream, perhaps. But here we see somebody else, Gab, celebrating Putin for what? For what? Banning porn. While in the meantime, he oversees the largest crisis of abuse and murder of women in the entire European continent. So let's see now, let's watch a segment from a video by Kraut, which explains the, you know, the Russian situation with domestic violence really well.
Let's go further back to another moment. Between the years of 2014 to 2017, topics and news stories are generally covered in this YouTube sphere like a conveyor belt. A news headline appears, is grabbed, the headline read, opinions given, and then channels move on to the next conveyor belt issue. On this conveyor belt, there were two topics that I abstained from covering. That being when footage emerged from Russia of female protesters getting beaten up by riot police, and when Sweden announced a feminist foreign policy. The footage of female protesters mainly made it into these awful SJW feminism wrecked BTFO compilation videos, or was uploaded to YouTube with titles such as How to Deal with Feminists, general attitude being that those Russians actually have a better idea of how to deal with these people than we do. The Swedish feminist foreign policy was of course an ideal headline to grab, add some Captain Sweden memes, laugh a little, and then consider the topic covered. I abstained from this topic because I knew what was actually going on. Russia has for years been plagued with an enormous domestic violence problem. To give you a measure of comparison, in the United States, a country with twice the population, an average of 11,000 women become victims of domestic violence each year, with there being 1,800 domestic violence murder victims. In Russia, a country with twice the population, an average of 36,000 women became victims of domestic violence every year, with 3,000 being murdered in domestic violence homicides every year throughout the 2000s. By 2013, the number had risen to 9,000 women being murdered by their partners every year. Under President Putin, Russian society pushed more and more to the political right in its social attitudes, a shift in the social climate strongly promoted by Putin's government.
So basically, Putin brought a wave of attitudes and policies that tripled the rate of murdered women by domestic violence.
Nationalist right-wing movements popped up throughout the country, promoting a vision of a resurrected, better, orthodox past. And within this climate, the same politician who had written, proposed, and pushed through Russia's anti-homosexuality laws introduced legislation to decriminalize domestic violence. This might sound insane to you, but this political proposal was widely praised and supported in Russia, the Russian Orthodox Church being one of its biggest supporters, who declared that beatings were a mere blessing which can help prevent the death of the soul. Protests against this legislation were met with the same hard-hitting police force with which the Russian government treated all protests. All of this came to a head in February 2017, when the Russian parliament passed the proposed legislation, with only one parliamentarian voting against it. Its changes to the laws in Russia, domestic violence was no longer a criminal felony, but a mere misdemeanor, punished with just a fine ranging from $100 to $500, or 10 days of community service. If a victim of domestic violence wanted to press charges, the burden of collecting evidence would no longer be on the police, but on the victim, like in a civil court dispute. If there was no evidence of physical damage, police were no longer required to even file for a criminal misdemeanor charge, let alone a felony. And police in Russia are no longer required to answer emergency calls reporting domestic violence.
These facts, these dirty facts, these gloomy facts about Russia and Putin have never been covered by Paul Joseph Watson. What he covered was 50 seconds of lip service to the word mother in an irrelevant discussion with a counsel. Amazing grift there, Paul, warrior of Western values. By the way, is respecting women and being tolerant to gay people a part of Western values or not?
In effect, Russia legalized wife beating in 2017. And from February 2017 to 2019, the already bad situation in Russia took a turn for the worse. The number of domestic violence victims every year in Russia rose to a staggering 600,000. Domestic violence now happens.
Get a grip of that number. 600,000 women per year is where the situation of domestic violence victims is right now in Russia. 600,000 women in a year being victims of domestic violence. And Putin is probably not even lifting a finger about it.
In one out of four Russian families. 72% of all calls to women's national helplines are not passed on to the police. 40% of all violent crimes happen inside families. 67% of all murders are linked to domestic violence. And 12,000 women are murdered by their partner every year. Some estimates put the number as high as 15,000 or even more. This means that in Russia, 38 women are murdered by their partner every single day. This is what you won't see on Russia Today, let alone from any of the other pro-Putin mouthpieces out there.
Russian women live in a post-feminist society, highlighting their femininity and benefiting from it. We don't have to...
These are the narratives the classical liberals and the culture warriors and the grifters are feeding people and feeding you if you're watching them. This is the filth. A nicely produced video with this lady here giving us a spiel is trying to whitewash a country that is literally going through a femicide.
Fight for our rights.
But also own the libs with what? With the argument from Russia. Russia, where a femicide is currently happening.
The Russian government initially tried to deny these developments, claiming the numbers were fake and produced. Western spies, despite the fact that the numbers came from Russian institutions. More and more people noticed how the situation got worse to such an extent that it could no longer be ignored. Even before decriminalization, some cases were so outrageous they made headlines, such as when a Russian news anchor beat his girlfriend into a coma by cracking her skull and then just dumped her lifeless body outside his house door. After decriminalization, the headlines filled with even more cases so outrageous that they couldn't be ignored. Women who had been assaulted by their husbands were forced to pay the fines for their broke violent husbands in a twisted perversion of justice. A Russian actor beat his wife to death by smashing a piece of wood laced with nails into her face 69 times. In Murmansk, the autopsy of a...
These are really gruesome details, and I regret, maybe, that I have to expose you, dear viewers, to such brutal content, but it is the truth that women face in Russia. Women who supposedly should be protected by the kind words of Putin, who likes the word mother, but instead they face daily risk of death from their own partners. And not of just death, gruesome, violent death. So we have to share a little bit of what the Russian women are suffering at the moment.
23-year-old revealed her husband beaten her to death with 130 kicks and punches. A Russian police officer laughed and joked when a woman called her for help. "If he kills you, we'll come examine your corpse," she said before hanging up the phone. 40 minutes later, her boyfriend had beaten her to death. And one of the most shocking cases was that of Anastasia Ovzianikova. Her boyfriend would beat her on a regular basis, but not enough with that, he would then take his phone and film her bruised and battered body as she...
I had to blur and censor the image. It's really brutal. It's really brutal. You don't want to know.
She would sob and beg him to stop beating her. then sent those videos to his friends or posted them on Russian social media.
Do you understand, people? This is a sadistic culture that targets women for torture and murder under Putin and his orthodox faker clan.
With comments like, "I know how to keep my woman under control." After she tried to break up the relationship, he dragged her out of a cafe and savagely beat her for several minutes in public without anyone intervening.
This is definitely a culture of misogyny, and do not take that word lightly. Women are dying and getting tortured here.
After he filmed what he had done to her, she fell into a coma and died of her injuries a week later. By late 2018, opinion polls showed that 49% of Russian women believed the most dangerous place for them was their own home. It is at this point possible that Russia under Putin has become a more dangerous place for women to live than Saudi Arabia and the other Islamic countries that have usually been the most dangerous. That's one hell of a thing for a society to accomplish. By December 2018 and early 2019, the domestic violence rate in Russia became so bad that even the Russian government, that almost never admitted to any wrongdoing, let alone mistakes, had to publicly admit that decriminalizing domestic violence had been a colossal mistake. The Russian government is currently trying to lower domestic violence by playing TV ads about how bad it is. No steps, however, have been taken to recriminalize domestic violence. Instead, the politicians who pushed for the decriminalization of domestic violence are now seeking to ban abortion.
You see, the deletion of women's rights continues. And the disgusting grifter scumbag Paul Joseph Watson is presenting Putin in rosy colors as an ideal leader that is fighting back to the globalists, you see? You see, this is the scum we have to deal with in the public discourse.
The Russian women you saw protesting in the wrecked feminism compilation videos were not blue-haired SJW brats demanding a safe space, but ordinary women from across Russia who throughout recent years have been vocally protesting what has been happening in their country and what was being done by their government. And the Swedish government's feminist foreign policy? You can read beyond the headlines and will find that it is a policy that is in large a reaction to events in Russia and even directed at Russia.
So, Sweden, who was laughed at by the grifter goons and the skeptics and the Sargonites for announcing a feminist attitude in their foreign policy, Sweden was the only European country vocally reacting to a bloody state-enforced and supported femicide, a mass murder of women taking place in Russia. Right now, yes, Sweden, that rainbow crazy country, yes, they were the only one who had the spine to be vocal about Russia's domestic violence and femicide problem. But, you know, the alternative media and the big heads of the reactionary YouTube, what did they focus on? Oh, that Sweden is ridiculous. The liberals have gone mad. How can you have a feminist foreign policy? Well, if you have a femicide happening in Europe, that's how you get a feminist foreign policy. I am disgusted by these scumbags that will not even go beyond a headline. And they will, you know, sweep the death of thousands of women under the carpet just to own the libs, just to keep on the anti-SJW narrative going. They should be ashamed of themselves.
Think of the Swedish left-wing government and its domestic policies what you may. Fact is, it is one of the few governments that actually bothered to condemn events and developments happening in Russia and even decided to do something about it. There is something curious and macabre here, especially when you read through the comments on those awful compilation videos. What you will notice is an online culture, or at the very least a political culture of engagement that has been built over years and is so heavily influenced and dictated by dividing the world into SJW and not SJW, right-wing good and left-wing bad, that people are unable to see beyond that simplistic two-dimensional perspective and are even spreading and just simply accepting false information. Never mind the fact that to the far-right denizens of the internet, there's probably nothing wrong with wife-beating as long as it's done by a white man.
Yes, unfortunately that's true. A shocking yet informative video, no less. I guess now we all have the picture of what women are really going through in Russia and why any lip service to the word mother by Putin is irrelevant. Shame on Paul Joseph Watson for whitewashing the man who presides over a femicide. And shame that there are people who believe and fund Watson and the Watsons of this world as if they are some brave warriors for truth or defending our Western values. How would you feel if 600,000 women in Germany and England were victims of domestic abuse each year? Would that be nice? Is this the fight against the globalists you want? All these things like the fight against globalists and stuff, all these things are facades. And behind the facades, you will find tyrants like Putin, con men like Alex Jones, and grifters like Paul Joseph Watson. There's nothing to it. If you want to hear about what's happening in the world, go read some serious source that delves into geopolitics. Stop listening to these buffoons. But there's more. Paul Joseph Watson is a warrior for free speech or a free speech extremist and all that crap. So, okay, because he's a pig-headed buffoon, I can understand that the femicide of women in Russia skipped his attention or was too inconvenient for his grift to mention. It's not excusable. He's an inhuman scumbag, but let's say I would expect that of him. What about freedom of speech, though? He support Paul Joseph Watson is supposed to be the free speech extremist, right? Well, what about the Moscow case? What is the Moscow case? It's fairly recent. Here, there's an article from October 30, 2019. Did any of the Sargonites, the free speech bros, did Molyneux cover this? Did Paul Joseph Watson cover this? Not as far as I know. Wouldn't be fine if we could ask them why they didn't cover this. So what is the Moscow case about? All this in Putin's Russia, by the way, that respects the word mother. In mid-July 2019, peaceful protests began in Moscow, triggered by the exclusion of independent candidates from the September 8 city legislature elections. Authorities responded with brute force, in many cases violently confronting the peaceful protesters. In July, 24 people were arrested on charges of mass rioting and or assaulting police. The mass rioting charges are groundless. Video footage of the events leading up to these arrests show police breaking up peaceful marches and assemblies. Right, but there's more. But here's the catch. Here's not only these were peaceful protesters that had a violent crackdown unleashed on them by Putin's people, but here's a nice catch that bridges well with free speech. 12 of the accused are in jail or under house arrest, including Yegor Chukov, a university student whose charges were changed from mass rioting to, quote, inciting extremism online. Weird. Let's see what he has to say. Let's see what Zhukov has to say himself. He calls this article the final word. A 21-year-old Russian political science student, Yegor Chukov, had his final word while on trial for the summer protests in Moscow on December 4, 2019. Here we stand publishes the full translation. Okay, so this is the Zhukov's own statement. The trial which is now taking place is devoted, first of all, to the words and their meanings. We have discussed specific phrases, nuances of formulations, methods of interpretations, and I hope we are able to prove to the respected court that I'm not an extremist from the point of view of both linguistic and common sense. So this person is held to court in Russia, no less, where going to prison is a serious case, for supposedly inciting extremism. Shouldn't be the free speech bros on this guy's side instead of the side of Putin? Who knows? Zukov continues, now I want to touch on things that are more fundamental than the meaning of words. I want to talk about the motives of my actions. It's great that the linguistics experts also spoke about them. These motives are genuine and deep. They are the motives that make me run for politics. These are also the motives out of which I used to record the videos for my YouTube channel, Zukov's blog. And here is what I want to begin with. The Russian state today positions itself as the last defender of traditional values. Much attention, we are told, is given to the institution of the family and patriotism. Christian faith is being called the key traditional value. Your honor, it seems to me, maybe this is even good. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. This is the major saying in Christian faith. Love is trust, compassion, humanism, mutual help, and care. A society that is built on such love is the strong society, and perhaps the strongest of all possible societies. So definitely this Zukov doesn't sound like a very, you know, chaotic, rebellious monster. He's a bit trad himself, as it seems, right? But to understand the motives of my actions, it is enough to look at how the Russian state, the one that proudly proclaims itself to be the defender of Christianity and therefore of these values, defends them in practice. There is an invisible barrier dividing our society into two categories. All the money is concentrated above, and nobody's going to give it away from there. And below, without exaggeration, only hopelessness is left. Realizing that they have nothing to rely on, realizing that no matter how hard they try, they cannot bring happiness to themselves or their family, Russian men take out all the anger on their wives, turn into alcoholics, or hang themselves. Russia holds the first place in the world by the number of male suicides by 100,000 people. As a result, single mothers constitute a third of all Russian families. And I want to ask, is that how we are defending the traditional institution of the family? So Zukov, this brave young man, was protesting peacefully. Putin, not from a perspective of radical, I don't know, liberal or whatever boogeyman the grifters would want to paint. Zukov was defending the values and the traditions that supposedly Putin is defending. Only Putin isn't defending anything apart from himself. He's an authoritarian ruler. And what happens here is maybe Paul Joseph Watson didn't want to cover this free speech story because he would have to perhaps report that this Zukov says that Putin defends none of the traditional values and doesn't defend the family as it's advertised. So we hear the Sargonites and the trads and the reactionaries on Western YouTube and Twitter moaning about the value of the family. Here is a guy that's about to go to prison in Russia for protesting Putin. And one of the reasons he protests is that families are destroyed in Russia by the economic disparity that leads men to suicide at alarming rates. It leads the same men to kill their women or physically abuse their women to multiple times of alarming rates. And it destroys the families where so many men have committed suicide that one third of the families are single mothers. Can you understand the level of human suffering and destruction that happens in Russia? Paul, Joseph, Grifter, Watson, can you? No, you can't, because you're a solar Patreon receiver, Patreon money receiver. That's what you people are. That's what the grifters are. They will say anything for the donations. They will ignore this amount of human suffering if it doesn't make a good headline against the Libs. And here's the deal. They skip this free speech battle. Actually, a detail you should know is that Zukov had this video blog that's actually the reason he was arrested instead of the protest. He was marked by the government for making critical videos against Putin. So this free speech battle was not covered by the free speech warriors. Why? Because it would be inconvenient in their narratives to own the libs. This is despicable. This is not only unprincipled and dishonest. This is the despicable promotion of a tyrant as a pretense to own the libs. And a tyrant that dissolves the working class in his country, he has his people face extreme circumstances, and that brings up the violence. He got domestic violence out of the heavy crimes legislation, and now it's rampant. People are killing each other in Russia, and grifters don't give a shit. Zhukov continues, the only social politics Russian government consistently pursues is separation. This is how the state dehumanizes us into each other's eyes. In the state's eyes, we have been dehumanized for a long time. How else such a barbaric treatment can be explained? The treatment that is stressed by everyday bludgeoning, torture in the prisons, ignoring of the HIV epidemic, closure of schools and hospitals, and so on. Let us look in the mirror. What have we become by letting them do this to us? Okay, so Paul, Grifter Watson, are you gonna let Putin do this to these people? Just to own the libs on Twitter, you filthy scumbag. This tells you all you need to know about grifters, people. And who is covering the story of this young man called Zhukov that is gonna go in Russian prison, which will probably destroy his life? Who is covering that? Is it the alternative media? Is it the grifters? Is it the free speech bros? Is it the Sargonites? No, no. They are against the vague globalist boogeyman, and Putin is their fighter. Blah! They're not covering this. Who is covering it? The mainstream media. The evil media. The media that the alternative media told you that are against free speech and pro-tyranny. They are covering what the tyrant is doing. They are covering what Putin is doing to Russian families, to Russian women. To this young lad who was just criticizing Putin. This is what Putin does to freedom, you scumbags. So, from now on, whenever you encounter a grifter or one of their minions talking pleasantly about Putin in rosy colors, tell them that they are supporting a tyrant who commits femicide and who divides his people to the very verge of destruction of society. Tell them, if they support Putin, they are femicide promoters. Thank you for watching. Heavy topic. GriftBits will continue in the future, hopefully with more light subjects that we can have a bit of fun with.